guess.
Ready? Delta WW0331, take 5.
Gonzalez and Sound Off every night on AM 750 WSB, Atlanta's news, weather, and traffic leader. It is 10:30, and with a quick update, let's go to our new
money in the big leagues.
I can eat $52 and ride a train to get there.
Well, I imagine there's a lot of those guys out there put it in the bank.
I'm sure.
Because I always got some, ball players have always been accused of being freeloaders. Now, why not? If somebody wants to buy your lunch, so be it.
You put that $7.50 away.
Keep it.
Hank, when does how far back does your association with the Crackers go? As a play-by-play guy,
I came here in 1954. I came here and went to Jacksonville with the kind of Cracker edition, Whitlow Wyatt's Club, which won the pennant, the All-Star Game, the playoff, and the Dixie Series. That was the year Bob Montag broke the all-time home run record. That was the year that seven of the starters on that team were hitting over 300 in August. That was one heck of a ball club. I mean, we went to Houston and whipped Houston for the
Dixie World Series.
Classic, yeah. After whipping everybody else, it was a remarkable year. And it was lucky for me that I got off to a good start because I was the new boy at the mic. And when you got a winner, you get credit for it, believe me.
But you became such a part, your voice and your description became such a part of the Crackers that it was hard to separate them in my mind. Anytime I still think about the Crackers, I think about normally about the way you describe something. And I like to think I was at a lot of games, but the highlights that I remember hearing you describe it. But we got some folks hanging on, and let's get to our phone. Let's talk some fans. Hey, we're going to start off with David. David, you're on with the gang. How you doing, David?
Ludlow.
Hi, buddy.
Joining the program tremendously this morning, but my question is not about baseball. I want to get out.
Okay, let me say this, David. Be very rude to bring these men. These men make hundreds of thousands of dollars for these appearances. You call me back tomorrow. We'll talk about anything you want to talk about, but today it's baseball, and don't be mad at me, pal. Call me back tomorrow. Let's talk to the Kansas kid. Hello, kid.
Hello.
How you doing?
Just fine.
Good.
Yeah, my father was an old baseball player, and he played in the Southern Association like in 1939. made it up to the big leagues and played 3 years for the old Boston Braves. And my question is, when he played with the Southern Association, his remembrance of Atlanta was that all the Southern home teams that Atlanta seemed a lot cooler to play in. Do you remember that?
You mean
the temperature-wise?
Temperature-wise. Well,
Atlanta is a higher altitude. We're talking about Sulphurdale. We're talking about the Delta in New Orleans. We're talking about the
Rosewood Park.
The Hardwood Park.
Right, and they played in the old
Rock.
Uniforms, too.
Yeah, I expect he's right. Who was your dad?
Elmer Butch Neiman.
Oh, yeah. See, I knew when you said 30s that we had at least one guy here that was going to know your old man.
Yeah, he was a long time player manager for the Topeka Owls in the old Triple I League too.
Well, we're glad you called, partner.
Can I ask one more question,
sure,
real quick?
Sure, certainly.
My question is what they think of expanding the league for two more teams. My father's thinking is that there's not that many quality big league players around anymore. For that many teams.
Let's start with Montag. Montag, what do you think?
Yeah, I've got to agree with you there. In fact, the late Paul Richards said the quantity is there, but not the quality. And I can assure you that it's going to do nothing but cut down on what little quality is there is today by adding more teams. But, you know, again, the way society is, more towns are building stadiums and more towns want ball clubs. So... what else are you going to do? The buck's out there, and that's what it's all about anymore.
I knew there was a shortage of players. I had a call last week from Augusta looking for catch for him next year.
Today's stars are bigger, better, faster, better trained, but the overall personnel, it's thinned out. It's dissipated to an extent. You see the big league play every now and then, and it's mostly by the same people who continue to make the big league play. The rest of them go chase a ball somehow.
Right? Bill? Well, in all deference to the people that are presently playing in Atlanta and elsewhere in the major leagues, I am sure I'm not the most objective guy in the world, but I frankly think a lot of that back in the minor leagues played like big leaguers, and a lot of the big leaguers now play like minor leaguers. I just get the impression that there's something missing in the whole game now. Whether adding more teams will add to it, I don't know. All right. Our number, 872-0750. We are talking minor league baseball, but baseball in general. If you have any questions or comments for my distinguished panel, hot dang, I love it. 872-0750. We're going to talk baseball. Stay with us. Let's talk to Ken. Ken, you're on AM 750 WSB.
Yes, I'm enjoying this very much. I don't hardly know where to start. I'm just appreciate having you guests on there. And my mind went back to the 53 World Series, and which I watched from one of my frequent positions, which is on top of a boxcar out there on the railroad track. And a lot of times I didn't have the money to get pay my way in, so we would sit out there on top of the boxcar and watch the game. But somewhere in my house, I have a picture of color pitch of the 1948, I guess the starting lineup for the Crackers, and couldn't remember all the names. I could remember Ev St. Clair, Al Flair, Davy Johnson, Chet Haddock, King Burwell, and also I couldn't remember the outfield. Which
was St. Clair here in 48? You sure that's 48, partner?
I'm pretty sure it is.
I don't think Sinclair was here.
No, Evan came here in 1950, the same year Eddie Matthews came.
Okay, was it Cliff Dapper then?
Yes.
Okay, but there's one that will never escape my memory, which was my hero when I was growing up, and that was the pride of Somerville, Ralph Country Frank.
Yeah.
he was what brought me to the ballpark, I guess, more than any one player. But you're talking about the players today as compared to players in the minor leagues. I think one thing that's missing is the love of the game. It seemed like they had a greater love of the game than the players do nowadays.
Let me tell you what's missing. The breath of the tiger. The hunger. The fact that you foul this up, idiot, and I'll have you chasing fly balls and punxsutawney. Now, at that point, they couldn't say, hey, I got $4 million in the bank. Do what you got to do. At that time, that man held your future in his hands, and it was a lot of yes, sir, and no, sir, I would think.
Well, this is true, and if memory serves me correct, it seemed like they got a lot of their players. You know, they had a lot of companies in the Atlanta area that had good ball players.
Correct.
And I seem like they got a lot of some of them from East Point forward. I believe Socko Stockwell did. Seemed like he played for the Crackers at one time.
That's correct.
And there were several companies in the Atlanta area that had produced some great ball players. But I'm enjoying the show, and like I say, it brings back a lot of memories to me. And those were some of the best days of my growing-up period, I guess, to spend out at Fonseca Park. So enjoy your show.
Glad you called, old friend. You take care of yourself. 872-0750. Leo, you're on AM 750.
Good morning, and I'm happy I didn't have to wait all that long.
Well, you did good, Leo.
Good morning to all of you. And,
good morning.
I have something for Hank, and I have something for Bob Montag.
All right.
Hank, I believe you'll agree with me that in 1954, the World Series was really played between Atlanta and the Houston Buffaloes in that 4-3 triumph of the Crackers. At the same time, Cleveland, which had won 111 and lost only 43 that same year, didn't win a single game from the New York Giants.
No.
I think we had the World Series down here. What do you say?
I'll never will forget when Houston came here for the first two games. They made us look so bad.
Didn't they?
It was pitiful.
And Ed Danforth, who was then sports editor for the Atlanta Journal, wrote a column after those first two games, "Let them have the Dixie Series, boys. You've made us proud already."
Yeah.
7-2 and 10-4 in those first two games.
And when Bill George went into a full windup with Bob Brown on third, and Brown stole home on him while he was in the middle of his windup, that was the most embarrassing thing I'd ever seen.
Absolutely, and you were having to call all that.
And then we went to Houston and Donovan beat him, and then it rained for 2 days. And
well,
then,
don't forget that fella Thompson.
And then Glenn Thompson came
Thompson
in.
Thompson kept us in the series by fanning 19 of those Buffaloes.
Well, that was a New Orleans game earlier, but he and then Donovan came back, and dang if we didn't whip him, and you know what Jim Solt did.
Yeah. And remember that Don McMahon, they got to him for the one game they won there at Houston. They got to him late in the game and won that one 5-2.
Yeah.
But the series was forced back to Atlanta, and those stands absolutely rocked with vibration when Jim Solt hit that bases-loaded home run.
But you have to remember
that, don't you?
Oh. Have to remember also, those stands rocked all the time. Anyway.
they did. Now, to Bob Montag.
Got about a minute.
Yes, sir. Bob, I admired your stroke as you hit home runs. It looked almost effortless as you swung. And I have thought about you over the years that if you had turned to golf and it had a swing like that in golf, you would have been a world beater in golf also.
Yeah, but the only problem is in golf you have to play the foul ball.
Yeah, that's true.
I took that up, and it didn't make a difference.
I think with a stroke in golf like your stroke in baseball, your drives would have been straight down the fairway.
Well, I still try to do that, but again, as I say, you know, when you're in the woods, it's pretty hard to see what's going on outside.
Yeah. Leo, I got to run, Leo. Take care, pal.
Thank you.
Thanks for the call. Our number, 872-0750, 1-800-WSB-TALK.
This is the best of Ludlow Porch. If you hear the phone numbers, please don't call. This show was pre-recorded for broadcast at this time.
Hi, this is Wes Minter. The debate for MARTA in Gwinnett County is getting hotter by the day. Coming up Monday afternoon at 1 o'clock, we'll bring that debate to my program with people from both sides of the issue, and your opinion will make it complete. Only here on AM 750 WSB.
Classic American cooking, Piccadilly. Hot roast beef, can't wait to eat it. Chicken fried steak, I can just see it. When you're in the mood to pick and choose Piccadilly. Fresh fruit salad, my oh my. Wait till you taste that lemon pie. When you're in the mood for good, quick food, Piccadilly. You can eat a little or eat a lot. What you want is what we got. The best and freshest variety. Oh, I can't wait to get to Piccadilly.
Mashed potatoes with steak too. Good fresh veggies for me and you. When you're in the mood to pick and choose Piccadilly.
Shrimp and fish and cool coleslaw. Banana pudding.
What a lunch.
Classic American cooking. Oh, I can't wait to sit down to it.
Piccadilly for lunch.
it's about 25 minutes past 5 o'clock in the morning here in Atlanta on AM 750 WSB, and let's see what Kirk Mellish has to say about the weather for today. It seems as though we have a partly sunny day coming up, look for a high of about 87 and a low overnight of 65. And on Monday, that is, more of the same. So 85, 86, 87 degrees, it's still almost like summertime, isn't it, huh? Kind of nice, too. Right now, our temperature on Peachtree Street is 61 degrees.
AM 750 WSB presents The Best of Ludlow Porch. If you hear the phone numbers, please don't call. This is a taped program.
I wish you could be here when these microphones are off. You're missing the best part of this game. Everybody drop what you're doing, come to WSB. Our number 872-0750, and we're talking minor league baseball with Bob Montag, Hank Morgan, and Bill Herndon, and we'd like to have you involved in this. Let's get right back to our phones, and Fred, you're on AM 750 WSB.
Good morning, Ludlow.
Hello, Fred.
How you doing?
Wide open.
First of all, I'd like to say I've been a Cracker baseball fan for many years, and enjoyed Hank Morgan and things, and I have to ask Hank Morgan a question.
All right.
How many teams could he name within the Southern Association first?
All of them? Now, we got that first match.
Well, you see, the league started in 1885, and although this is not that well known, Atlanta replaced Selma, Alabama in 1903, I guess it was. So everybody in this part of the country was in the original Southern Association, which was called the Southern League. Then they reorganized it in 1901, and six of the teams that wound up in it in 1959 were still in it. I mean, we're the original teams, six of them. That was Nashville, Birmingham, Memphis, Little Rock, Atlanta, Birmingham, Mobile. Is that six?
Yeah.
Nashville.
And then Little Rock was in, and they gave up and went to Shreveport, and then they gave up and went to Columbus, and then they gave up and went to back to Little Rock, and then they gave up and went back to Montgomery, and then they went back to Macon. And that's everybody that was ever in this.
Another question I'd like to ask Hank now. I believe you'll know who I am when I say this. Radio station, I'm not going to call the station out, but I'll say the dial, 1010.
Yep.
Lakewood Park.
Yep.
I was the one that won the River Yell contest so many times.
You talk about the Big Gun Fair show.
Big Gun Fair, Lakewood Park.
We used to take over Lakewood Park and start at 6 o'clock in the morning and go till 8 o'clock at night with 1,900 hillbilly bands and 14,000 million people and hot dogs and hamburgers and hooping and hollering and hog calling.
I was the first one out there for last two years they had it. First one out there. I lived just a little ways from it, so I could get out there first.
And you won what contest now?
Yeah, the Rebel Yell contest.
Rebel Yell. How many years in a row did you win that?
Two years in a row.
Did you ever figure out a way to make money off of that? I would think a man can do that. I ought to make a dollar or two off of it.
I never did try that more.
When I was at the Big Gun, I used to recreate the Cracker baseball game of last night the next day. Wasn't that stupid? But it was sponsored. That's how much I would get up the next day and gather all the teletype stuff and get on the air and recreate last night's ball game in the middle of the day, the next day.
Well, let me answer your question by saying if it was sponsored, it wasn't stupid.
No, you're right.
Nothing sponsored is stupid. 872-0750. And Thomas, you're on AM 750. How you doing, Thomas?
Ludlow.
Yes, sir.
Thomas from the fantasy land of Webb.
Oh, well, good to have you.
Okay. you guys talking about the Crackers.
Just, yeah.
Brings back memories of childhood that I treasure. My granddaddy used to walk me down. We lived on Bonaventure Avenue.
Yeah.
And Ponce de Leon. And we'd go down and have a snack at the little family-operated corner restaurant and then walk down to the ballpark.
And the ballpark's where you really had your dinner.
Well.
The hot dogs and peanuts.
Well, Grandma made us go to the little family restaurant.
Yeah.
Make sure I get the stuff I needed. Then I picked out on hot dogs and, you know, popcorn and peanuts. But I tell you what, the Cracker Stadium and those guys out there, to me, that is better than what I see now. When, you know, with the Braves, I guess maybe it's part of my childhood. That's so special to me.
Well, let me tell you, that is special. Well, let me tell you something else that makes Ponce de Leon was a better place to watch baseball than Atlanta Stadium. Now, it wasn't as sterile, the bathrooms weren't as clean, and it wouldn't get as many folks in there. But when once you got in there, it was a better place to watch baseball. Do y'all agree with that?
Absolutely. Yeah. And what I used to want to do, if they had the scoreboard back up there, and I'd watch these guys. And their kids, like me, go up there and change the numbers.
Yeah.
And I always wanted to do that.
Well, certainly. Anybody, only a fool would not want to do that.
I'd have given my left arm to do it.
I'd rather done that than worked at Rich's.
Another thing is you saw good baseball.
Well, that's the thing. Sears building was right across the street.
Still there.
Yeah. And I guess I'm giving away my age now. There were cobblestone streets, and I remember one time they had the Budweiser wagon come down through there with the Clydesdales.
Oh, yeah.
With some big playoff game or something the Crackers were having. And the Philip Morris kid was out there on the street.
Johnny Roventini.
I tell you what, I would like to see those times again.
You take care of yourself. Good to hear from you. We're going to talk to Big Al on AM 750 WSB. What do you say, Big Al?
Hello, Ludlow.
How you doing, cousin?
Pretty good. I got a question to ask Mr. Montag.
All right.
Whatever happened to Doug Clements?
Well, you know, Doug played, as I think Hank will back me up on that, Doug played in the Cardinal organization. I think there was, 62 or 63? I really couldn't tell you. I know who you're talking about, mm-hmm. and he was a good ball player, but he was in the Cardinal chain, and by that time I had pretty much divorced myself of, even though I went out to Ponce de Leon Park during those years, I really didn't keep up with it as much as I had up until that time.
Well, Bob, he went, half that ball club we had here in 62 went up and became world champions in 1964? Doug Clemens, Johnny Lewis, Bill
Yeah, but
Gage.
What I think he's getting at, he would, you know, well, would like to know if what we knew where he is now.
But he did play for the Cards, you know.
He could be a manager or a coach or a scout for the Cardinals. That's not out of the question.
When I was a kid, I went to the Ponce de Leon ballpark and, you know, they used to eat popcorn and everything like that. And I got a chance one time in between a game to talk to Doug Clements, you know, out on the field. And he autographed one of the programs for me. And I'd like to find out where he was so I could write to him again.
Well, why don't you try getting in touch? I'll give you a clue how you can do this. Call the Brave office and they'll give you the address, St. Louis Cardinals. And I'm sure they'd be happy to lead you in the right direction.
Al, we thank you for joining us. This is the Best of Ludlow Porch. If you hear the phone numbers, please don't call. This show was pre-recorded for broadcast at this time.
Speak your mind. Call 1-900-726-2233. Tell your elected officials what you think. Call 1-900-726-2233. Make things happen. Call 1-900-726-2233. With the ease of a phone call, your voice will be heard on important issues or listen to what other Americans think. Call 1-900-726-2233 now and also vote in the daily polls. Results are tabulated and sent to your local senators or appropriate action group. Call 1-900-726-2233 and talk about anything on your mind. Topics change daily. 1-900-726-2233 operates 24 hours a day. The cost is 99 cents a minute, $1.99 for the first minute. Call 1-900-726-2233 now. You know you should.
What a disgrace, getting drunk like that at your sister's graduation party. You should be ashamed of yourself.
You can preach.
A drinking problem. He's only 14. He doesn't have a drinking problem. It's a phase.
You can deny.
If you come home drunk again, mister, you are gone out of my house. And don't think I won't do it. Do you hear me?
Let him.
You have got to stop. I'm begging you. Please.
Beg.
You're a drunk. Just look at you. Look at you. A drunk.
Or yell. But if your son or daughter has a drinking problem, the best thing you can do is call. We're the National Council on Alcoholism and Drug Dependence. We help thousands of people every year. Call us at 1-800-475-HOPE. That's 1-800-475-HOPE. Get through to us, and we'll help you get through to them. Just don't give up. This public service message brought to you by the National Citizens Commission on Alcoholism and the Advertising Council.
Sunday on AM 750 WSB.
The Atlanta Falcons bring the battle home. From New Orleans, the Saints come marching in and go crawling out. All the action gets underway with the Tailgate Show at 11:05. Don't miss a minute. Take your radio to the stadium and lock it on. AM 750 WSB.
Talking minor league baseball, the way we was on AM 750 WSB. Bill Herndon is here with us, Bob Montag, Hank Morgan, having a big time. Let's get right back to the phones and talk to Joe on AM 750 WSB. Hi, Joe.
Hey, Ludlow. First time calling?
Welcome, sir.
How are you, sir?
Doing good.
I want to ask Hank or either Bob if they remember a second baseman with the Crackers, and he played through the years with Bob Montag. And he never made the major leagues, as far as I know. His name was Frank DePrima.
Itchy.
Oh, yeah. Well, Frank
Where is Frank DePrima?
Frank is living and very prosperously in Paoli, Pennsylvania. He owns an auto parts business. And I saw Frank, was a good 5 or 6 years ago. But Frank's in good health and good financial position, and you're well, right, he never made the big leagues.
He didn't make the majors, but he out-hustled Pete Rose in my book. He was my hero.
Well, he was a very, very big name. There's no way to been involved in baseball at all during that period without knowing about Frank DePrima. He was here and big.
He always come out with a dirty uniform.
He was dependable. Did you know what a fine trumpet player Frank DePrima was?
I didn't know.
Frank was a trumpet player from his late teens and early years before he got into baseball. He played with name bands. He was one heck of a trumpet player. He was an accomplished musician.
Interesting.
He could read.
Interesting.
Well, I appreciate that information.
Glad you called, pal. Take care of yourself.
Okay.
Cawthorn, you are on AM 750 WSB. How you doing? Hello there.
Hi, are you asking for Katherine?
Yeah, Katherine, okay,
hi.
Excuse me.
I got a beep there and didn't hear the name.
Bless you. Where are you calling from?
From Rome, Georgia.
Okay, good to have you.
Thank you. I grew up in a household with some of the greatest old-timer baseball stories. My dad was playing for Auburn back in, 1928 and 29. Is it Hank or Bill that's the old-timer in the group?
I'm not going to say that. I'll just hit right in the mouth.
Okay.
Let me say that in spite of Bill's tender years, he goes way back with the Crackers.
Okay, well, we'll go with Bill.
Okay.
One of my fondest stories is my dad talking about that in the summertime, the kids that played at Auburn would get recruited by these mill teams in the surrounding areas to go in and play ball for them in the summer. And, of course, this was back during the Depression. They'd put them up in these mill houses, and they'd feed them all summer long, and so they got taken care of that way. And all the train trip stories, I guess, are some of my favorites, with the pillow fights and so forth. My dad graduated from Auburn in 1930, and he got drafted by the old Philadelphia Athletics team and went to play for them. And
what was his name?
he's one of the few around that has played in games with people like Lou Gehrig and Babe Ruth. Somebody called him a couple of years ago, and no, I guess this has just been the last few months that somebody had called him and told him that he was the last living member of the 1931 Philadelphia Athletics team. And I don't know how thrilled he was to hear that he was the last one left, but baseball's given such pleasure to so many people.
Who's your dad, Katherine?
His name is Folly Carter, and they called him Buck Carter at some point during his baseball playing. I don't know if that was when he was playing, you know, around in the Southern Association. After he left Philadelphia Athletics, he went into the Memphis League and put himself through optometric college in Memphis playing baseball for them. So he kind of toured the whole South in terms of baseball.
That's what most old retired umpires get into an optometric school.
Is it? Well, he had his mind made up that's what he wanted to do, and he said, of course, there wasn't any money back in those days to send yourself to school if you didn't have any, and that, you know, that baseball's what allowed him to get through school. And that's how he met my mom, really, was playing baseball for the Memphis League. Met her in Jackson, Tennessee, and to take her out on a date that night, the porter that was the one that traveled with the baseball team, he borrowed his suit to take her out on a date in, because he didn't own one. And he's got some of the greatest stories about the train trips and the pillow fights. And
I hope June Allison plays your mama when they make that movie.
Well, it'd make a great movie. I don't think he realizes how much, you know, we enjoy hearing it. We really have to kind of pick all this information out of it.
You make him tape record it. It's important. It's part of our history, part of our heritage. You make him put it down on tape.
Every week, my dad's 84 now, and in great health, plays golf 3 or 4 times a week. So baseball must be good for you.
I promise. Listen, I got to run, Katherine.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Call us again.
Okay, bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Hi, Fun Seekers. Ludlow Porch. Hey, I hope you're enjoying this broadcast of one of my earlier programs. Remember, you can hear my show live weekdays at 9 a.m. Right now, let's get a check on the weather forecast.
I'll be happy to do that, Luddy. You're at about 18 minutes away from 6 o'clock. Here's what Kirk Mellish has to say about our weather for the day. Sunday, of course, up and coming. The outlook for today, partly sunny with a high of 87, a low of 65, and then we get more similar weather on Monday. All right, our temperature now holding pretty steady at 61 degrees.
From the Hometown Radio Show, weekday afternoons 4 to 7, Gero McKee. Having a good weekend? Getting a lot of mud for your turtle? Join us on Monday because we'll talk about your 15 minutes of celebrity. Have you had it yet? What's happened? And it's all on AM 750 WSB.
Hi, this is Bobby Harper for Opti World, the one-hour eyewear and eye care centers in the Atlanta area. You know, with all the talk about one-hour service and the wide selection, the most important thing to the people at Opti World is taking good care of your eyes. And Opti World's idea of an eye exam, for example, includes tests for glaucoma, peripheral vision, and visual acuity. In fact, you'll receive over 20 tests in all, one of the most complete eye exams in the business. And it was certainly the most thorough eye exam I've ever had, and I believe it was better because of all the high-tech equipment they use. You know, being a superstore, Opti World can afford more sophisticated equipment than smaller optometric practices can. And this equipment takes some of the guesswork out of the exam, and I believe provides a better prescription. Sure, Opti World has great eyewear, but thanks to their highly trained doctors of optometry, they also have great eye care. Stop in today. There's Opti World stores all over the Atlanta area, and as I always say, you can do no better than dealing with the professionals at Opti World.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Frank Perdue.
Words just can't describe all the delicious flavors of my Perdue Dunnett Nuggets and Wings. So I've created a little medley. First, there's the classics, my original chicken nuggets and hot and spicy wings. But now there's also my turkey nuggets and cheddar cheese nuggets. And as for my wings, there's teriyaki style, barbecue flavor, plus a new one coming in late October, garlic butter and herb wings. So whatever you have a taste for, look for my fresh, already cooked nuggets and wings. They'll be music to your mouth.
When it comes to chicken, Frank Perdue is even tougher than you are because all his Dunnett nuggets and wings come with his name on them and his money-back guarantee. All big stars have fresh Perdue Dunnett nuggets, tenders, and hot spicy wings on sale. Why not stop in and buy some?
This is my...
Folks been holding on for a while. Let's get right back to our phones because we're talking baseball. Frank, you're on AM 750 WSB. Hello there.
Hey, Ludlow, how are you this morning?
I'm fine, Frank. How you doing, buddy?
It's one of the highlights of your shows. We listen to it a lot, but when you have those kind of people there, it's really a lot of fun.
Thank you. It's a highlight of my day, I tell you.
I wasn't fortunate enough to be around Atlanta back when the Crackers were here, but we certainly relived a lot of the highlights of the games with Bob and my old partner up here at my office, Phil. Now, I want to tell you something about Bob that I'm sure you know, but maybe a lot of the other people don't know, and he is a great storyteller, but, you know, he's out there working a lot for other people. He does a lot for the blind here in Atlanta. And back when a group that I'm with was trying to put on a public awareness meeting, a fundraiser-type show, the NDSC, Bob was the first one to come in and lend a hand and get some other people to help us. And, Bob, I want to publicly thank you for that.
Frank Murphy,
yep,
I appreciate that.
Well, you're a very nice man, and I'm sure the others are equally nice, but it's really good to...
We are. You were right about that. I think probably most of us here are nicer than Montag. As I look around, well, I know I certainly am, and I think probably speaking of the other two, I think they're at least as nice, or perhaps a little nicer than Montag. No, If we start talking about what Bob Montag does for this city, what he's meant for this city over the years, it would require a much longer show than we're going to have today.
Well, it's a good feeling to be able to call him a friend.
I'll go that one more time and say I appreciate it, pal.
You take care.
All right, pal. Hang
in there.
Tell
Paul Spaghetti hello.
I'll do it.
Take care.
That name's familiar. Let's talk to Jim. Jim, you're on AM 750 WSB.
Ludlow.
Hi there.
Hi. First time caller. I listen to you a lot.
Welcome. Partner, welcome.
I've got a question for Hank.
All right.
First thing I want to tell him, though, you know, there's only three things that kept me out of baseball. You know, I couldn't run or couldn't hit and couldn't kick.
Other than that, you were a prospect.
Oh, I was great. I was going to ask him, you know, how well-known this Harry Carey is in Chicago. I wanted you to know, Hank, that back in the 50s, you were just as well-known here in the state of Georgia as he is up there today. But I want to ask you one question. Back, I believe it's in 1950, 51, or 52. Now, Dixie Walker was the manager of the Crackers, and Whitlow White was the pitching coach. Was he the first pitching coach that the Crackers ever had?
I truly can't say.
I don't think so.
I don't think so. Both of Dixie won the pennant in 50 and Whitlow won it in 54.
Uh-huh.
That's about all I know about it, that Whitlow was Dixie's pitching coach.
Yeah.
I can't truly say. Bill, what do you know about it?
No, I think they had, for instance, Hugh Casey served as kind of pitcher, relief pitcher, and a pitching coach, as did Kirby Higbee.
What years?
Oh, I was earlier than that, but I don't know just what years, but...
Well, Hugh was here in 50.
Yeah.
But they had both Whitlow and Hugh Casey.
That's correct.
But, you know, after when Whitlow took over as manager, that was the end of the pitching coaches for the Crackers. The manager was the manager, pitching coach, and traveling secretary, and bus driver.
But another question. You ever see anybody run any funnier than Dixie Walker did?
Coochie Hartsfield.
I remember in Chattanooga, we went up there to see. That's the only time I could get to see the Crackers when they was in Chattanooga. I couldn't afford to go to Atlanta. And I seen them in a doubleheader up there. That's when Eddie Matthews, you know, was back just a snotty-nosed youngin', but one whale of a ball player. And I remember Dixie Walker on third base, and Whitlow was the coach. And I believe it was Ever St. Clair that hit one to the light tower there in old Ingle Stadium, you know, the old light tower right out in the playing field in center field. And he wound old Dixie up to go home. And he just barely did slid in. He just barely slid under the catch, and that thing was hit all the way to that light tower.
I'm glad you called me, man. I got to get out of here, make room for all the news, and then we'll be right back talking more baseball. Stick around and enjoy. As a matter of fact, give us a call, 872-0750, 1-800-WSB-TALK.
You're listening to the best of Ludlow Porch. Stay tuned for more following the news on AM 750 WSB.
Grew up dreaming of being a cowboy and loving the cowboy ways. Pursuing the line of my high-riding egos, I burned up my childhood days. I learned all the rules of a modern-day drifter. Don't you hold on to nothing too long. Just take what you need from the latest and leave them with the words of a sad country song. My heroes have always been cowboys, and they still are unseen. Sadly in search of one step and back of themselves, and their slow proven dreams.
nightmare, knowing well that your best days are gone. Picking up a good